I wanted to share something with you guys tonight while I was still fresh in my mind before we got into the word. But before we do that, let's pray. Father God in heaven, we are just so grateful, Lord, for being our God, the true God of the Bible, the true and living God, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, that we can come together like this as a family, Lord, to lift up your name and song and praise and worship and by your word. And so, Father, we pray that you would be amongst us tonight. Fill this room with your spirit, and you be glorified. And Lord, we lift up Byron and his family, Lord, and just pray, Lord, or for Johnny and his family, and that you would just have mercy. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, I've mentioned from time to time from this pulpit that I'm one of those, some people might call it nostalgia. I call it inventory. I take inventory of my life and where God has brought me and what's happened in my life. And since I've been a Christian for some 26, however many years, I've been seeing some amazing things happen. I've seen God do some wonderful, wonderful things in changing people's lives. But the thing that always gets me, and I get really emotional about it, is when God allows me to be a part of something that I have no right to be a part of. Because I remember my past, I remember what I was, and where God lifted me up out of. And for all purposes, according to the world, there's no way I should be anywhere close to, near, in the vicinity, or part of some of the things that God's allowed me to be a part of. Today was such a day. Unfortunately, I can't share with you everything about it because it's kind of a surprise that you guys will find out about soon, in a few months. But as I was participating in this thing that took place today, I sat in amazement, and all I could think about was, Lord, why me? Why me? I'm the guy that used to run around and my best days was looking for something to stick up my nose or to smoke, you know, to get high and to do everything that was totally against what you had called us to do. And I couldn't help but see the glory and the goodness of our risen Lord, of our Savior, and think about the fact that he lifted me up out of the gunk that I was living in, and he washed me off and put a clean robe on me and said, okay, here you go. And then not just set me up on my feet, but God said, I got a job for you to do. I have a job for you to do. And he sat me in his pulpit. He put me in a places of authority where I can tell people about my Savior. And for me, what more can a Christian want than to share the gospel of Jesus Christ? To be able to just go forth and just speak to people and open your heart to them and let them know there is a God. He's real and he lives and I've seen him and I know he's real. I know he's real. And the things that have happened in my life could happen no other way, no other way than by the hand of God. And to watch people's eyes in disbelief that, yeah, right, sure. But as you begin to expound on where God has brought you from and how he's changed your life, you begin to see ears perk up and people to take interest. And at the very least, there's a question or two to open a door for you to confirm what you've said. brothers and sisters, I know I've said it many times from this pulpit, but I love being saved. I love being saved. And I cannot imagine my life without Christ in it. I can't imagine missing out on the things that he's allowed me to see and to be a part of. And a lot of that includes most of you guys in this room. The things that I've seen God do in your life and the testimonies that we share together. But outside of these doors, the many doors that God has opened for me, for Cindy, for my family, and just to be a witness to. And so I just wanted to share that with you guys too. And I don't know, maybe somebody needed to hear that tonight. Maybe you needed some encouragement tonight. But I'm telling you guys, I don't deserve any of it. And I know we all say, well, none of us deserve it. And that's true. That's true, but isn't it nice that he has blessed us in such a way that we can receive that and we can be a part of the work that he's called us to do and to put our hands in it and roll up our sleeves and to get dirty and do it with a smile on our face and a joy in our heart and a leap in our steps and be excited and saying to the glory of God. To the glory of God. Anyway, open your Bibles to Ezekiel chapter 6. And I love you guys too. I really love you guys. You guys are so awesome. You put up with me despite my wife Cindy, and I just. I know a lot of you guys pray for me after you meet Cindy, and I appreciate that. Hey, I've had to deal with her for 40 years, and you know what? I'm looking forward to 40 more with her. It's all good. It's all good. Ezekiel chapter 6. So last week, we talked about in chapter 5, there was the discussion of Ezekiel cutting off his hair and separating it. The prophecies of chapter 6 and 7 are related in that they elaborate on this symbolism of chapter 5. However, each chapter has this distinct message and emphasis. With denunciation after denunciation, Ezekiel strove to move the heart of the nation back to the Lord. Whether they would hear or refused, they had to know that there was a prophet speaking for the Lord. Verse 1 of chapter 6. And the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, set your face towards the mountain of Israel and prophesy against them, and say, mountains of Israel, listen to the word of the Lord God. Thus says the Lord God to the mountains, the hills, the ravines, and the valleys. Behold, I myself am going to bring a sword on you, and I will destroy your high places. So it's as if God is saying, hello, hello, is anybody listening? Is there anybody at home? He speaks to the mountains and the hills and the valleys and the ravines. He speaks to the land. It's God's way of saying, wake up, listen, I'm calling to you. John Corson wrote this, not me. Not only would the mountains listen at the command of God, but they were also fully prepared to speak at his command. As in Luke 19:40, where it says, but he answered and said to them, I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out. Oh, that we would obey our Creator so readily. God's sword would destroy Israel's high places. Now, we all know a high place was usually, though not always, a place of worship located on a hill or a mountain. The elevated site supposedly brought worshipers closer to God. While a high place could include a temple, most high places had only altars for offering sacrifice. High places were in Canaan before Israel arrived, and God had commanded Israel to destroy them. That was in Numbers chapter 33. Israel was to worship only at the tabernacle placed at Shiloh. Hezekiah in the 8th century and Josiah in the 70th century removed the high places, but their reformation was temporary in character. After the death of these godly kings, they reverted to their old practices, the people did. The sword which God threatened them was that of the invading armies of Nebuchadnezzar, which would put an end to their high place worship. Verse 4. So your altars will become desolate, and your incense altars will be smashed, and I will make your slain fall in front of your idols. I will also lay the dead bodies of the sons of Israel in front of their idols, and I will scatter your bones around your altars. Now, in all ancient religions, the scattering of bones coming into contact with dead objects desecrated the altar of their god. So these people would not be even accorded the dignity of a decent burial. Here, their own bodies, dead bodies, will defile their altars. Verse 6, and all your dwellings, cities, will become waste, and the high places will be desolate, that your altars may become waste and desolate. Your idols may be broken and brought to an end. Your incense and altars may be cut down, and your works may be blotted out. Now make no mistake about it, sin is destructive, and we see that here. As much as these groves and high places brought them much joy, they were going to become their graves, as God was going to bring judgment upon them for their idolatry. Keep in mind that Jerusalem had not been destroyed by the Babylonians yet, but it was coming. And as you read through these verses, you see that everything they placed their trust in was going to be taken away in this judgment, falling in the hands of an angry God, allowing God to bring judgment upon you, despite the fact that you know what you're doing is wrong. Says something, right? Says something about us. You would think by this point, with as many that have already been taken into captivity, they would have been awakened out of their spiritual sleep. But it hasn't awakened them yet. And God was going to finish the work the nations was going to go into captivity. Verse 7, the slain will fall among you, and you will know that I am the Lord. Notice why God is doing this. You shall know that I am the Lord. He wants them to repent and return to him. And we will see this thought over and over again in this chapter. Some four times in these 14 verses, in fact, you shall know that I am the Lord. There is no God like our God. He stands alone, and people can either accept it or reject it. Isn't it something when we make it clear, when we witness to people, when we talk to them about the true and living God, and we give them everything that we think that they need as far as evidence that he's real. The most important thing and the obvious thing is our changed life, right? We say, look at me, look at what God has done in my life. And yet, they reject it. And when we talk about our own life, we can speak with authority because obviously we know what's happened with us. We know that there's been a true change in our life. And we go into detail after detail after detail about where we were and where has God brought us. And you see people sort of eyes just sort of looking up at the ceiling, and showing a disinterest in what we're saying, and your heart aches for them because you know if only they would just take hold, they would begin to see. We have family members like that, right? People that we've been witnessing to for years and talking to about the Lord. And even what really is bad is those ones who have seen the change in your life, who acknowledge it, but the world has such a hold on them that they just can't let go. They won't let go for whatever reason, and you just plead with them, look, and they say, yeah, I know, I see it. I see it, the change in your life. And you just wonder, what hold? I think I've mentioned a few times from up here that one Thursday night Karen was praying, remove every stronghold. That's been my prayer for those people that I love that won't come. Remove every stronghold that has them bound to this worldly life. Because we love them and we want them to come and take part in what we have to offer. If they reject it, they need to understand, though, that there are consequences to their actions. God's wrath will come upon their lives. When I talk to the guys at the jail, one of the things we talk about is the consequences. And I make it very clear to them, guys, listen, there's consequences to accepting and rejecting, okay? If you accept him, it costs you something. And they look at me and I'm like, yep, it costs you something. It costs you your whole life. You gotta give him your whole, you gotta give it all to him. You give it all to him. I said, if you reject him, it costs you your whole life. But you don't get the choice of giving it to him, okay? Because in the end, he's gonna take it. He's gonna take it. But the difference is what you hear when you get there. Enter in or depart from me. There's a consequence to it. Accepting him and giving it all to him means that you have the creator of the universe who's in your corner, who's got your back, who's holding you in the palm of his hand, who says that you're the apple of his eye, who's got your name written on the palm of his hand, who's standing there as your lawyer, as your advocate. If you reject him, none of that is true for you. None of that is true for you. Heaven or hell, make your choice. There's a consequence. Children of Israel, they're going to face the consequences of their decision. Verse 8. However, I will leave a remnant for you, for you will have those who escape the sword among the nations when you are scattered among the countries. God will not judge all the Jews. He'll leave behind in every country a faithful remnant who remains loyal to him. And that's always been the case throughout the Bible. Again, a sign of our great God and his love and his compassion, that remnant that he leaves. The presence of a remnant underlines the mercies of God in spite of man's failure. The presence of a remnant indicates an easing of the dire punishment so amply deserved by the nation. Do they deserve it? No. But again, we see God's mercy involved in it. Verse 9, then those of you who escape will remember me among the nations to which they will be carried captive, how I have been hurt by their adulterous heart, which turned away from me, and by their eyes, which played the harlot after their idols. And they will loathe themselves in their own sight for the evil which they have committed for all their abominations. Then they will know that I am the Lord. I have not said in vain that I would inflict this disaster on them. Right here, we see the heart of God for his people, for us. The Lord was broken over their unfaithfulness. To me right there, that says a lot. That says a lot. I'm one person amongst all of God's creation, and yet God's heart is broken because someone like me in my unfaithfulness can break the heart of the Creator of the universe. Can you imagine a whole nation, a whole city, a church, who have turned away from the true and living God to go their own way, to practice a lifestyle that's not ordained by our God, that our God's heart can be broken, that Reggie, that I can do something like that. And that's a humbling thought. That's, wow. All I can say is wow. They had wandering eyes and went after other lovers, leaving the Lord. But make no mistake about it, judgment will come upon them for their actions. Again, another scary thought. You know the consequences of your actions, and yet you proceed anyway. These are not idle words by the Lord. They will know who the true and living God is. Listen again to what the Lord was doing with them. And they shall know that I am the Lord, and that I have not said in vain that I would bring this calamity upon them. In other words, they need to pay attention because the Lord is going to bring about what he has promised. And the desired outcome of all this is that they will know that he is a true God. They will know that I am the Lord. Do we know he is the Lord? Yeah. Verse 11. Thus says the Lord God, clap your hand, stamp your foot, and say, alas, because of all the evil abominations of the house of Israel, which will fall by the sword, famine, and pestilence. So the Lord tells Ezekiel to clap his hands and stamp his feet. Why? Once again, to get the people's attention, to awaken from their sleep. Make no mistake about it, Ezekiel was a very animated prophet, as we've seen. And as he's doing this, he then speaks of judgment that's coming because of all their abominations before the Lord. There is no escape. I think there's an important lesson for us. Who are we serving? Who are we going to worship? Will we sacrifice our lives to idols and in the end die worshiping them? Or will we sacrifice our lives to the Lord as a living sacrifice, dying to self and living to him? One of my prayers every morning and throughout the day is, Lord, help me to die to self. Because one thing I know about myself is I'm a pretty selfish individual. Not like you guys. All it is about, you know, we sing that song, it's all about you, Lord. But in my heart at times, it's all about you, Reggie. I won't sing it, so okay. Paul put it like this in Romans chapter 12. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove that what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. The choice is ours. It's our choice. We've all been Christians long enough to know that idolatry is a subtle thing. In fact, here in the modern Western world, it's hard for us to imagine anyone still practicing idolatry. Though we know that there are certain religions that do, but from us it seems so far removed, at least the kind of idolatry that we see here in the Old Testament, right? We cannot imagine bowing down to a wooden figure or a stone figure and bringing sacrifices to it. But we must never forget that anything can be an idol in our life. I like the way one pastor described it, described idolatry. Idolatry is the elevation of a preliminary concern to ultimacy. Life is full of preliminaries, making money, buying a house, going on vacation, how the Redskins will do this season. But when a preliminary gets exalted to ultimacy, it becomes an idol. Our hearts are fickle. They get easily distracted and get preoccupied with lesser things. Idols are everywhere, and we know that. Last week when I was over at the jail, I asked the guys, I said, listen, let me ask you guys a question. How many of you guys in here have really, really nice cars? And about five or six hands went up. And I asked them, tell me about your car. And, you know, some of them, you know, they got, and I'm old, so what they were saying really just sort of went over my head because I don't understand it anymore, the lingo that they're talking. I have 22s on it, and I have spinners, and I have all this kind of, and they were talking about all the things that they have on their car, you know, and the kind of stereo system. I'm used to, like, a radio with two speakers, and that's, but they were telling me about, you know, the whole system and everything. And so I do this, I give them a chance, because they're all excited about telling me about their cars, and they're really into it, and describing what was going on with their car, and the sound system, and the what was under the hood and everything. So then I asked, okay, so how much time do you spend washing and detailing that car? And these guys were like every other day, you know, 20 hours a week, 30 hours a week. How much money do you spend on it? These guys are sitting on, remember, these are guys who are in jail. They can't get out. Some of them can't get out because of bond money. Because the bond money has been spent on detailing their car out, okay? And these guys are telling me they spend thousands of dollars on fixing their car up and making sure that it's clean to ride down the street to get dirty again. You know, but they're all excited about it. They're really, really excited about it. And I said, so what do you guys think of idolatry? Oh, idolatry's bad. You know, I would never bow down to any idol. I said, really? Really? So you guys can see where this is going, right? You know, I said, you guys realize, right, that car has become your idol. No, it hasn't. That car is not, I don't bow down to that car. When you're down there doing those wheels and you got that little teeny brush and you're getting every little speck of dirt out of those rims, what are you doing? Well, I'm just cleaning my car. Okay. Your car has become your idol. It has consumed so much of your time, so much of your life, so much of your resources. That's kind of like what an idol does. Open your eyes. And same thing for us. Even in the church, we'll say, well, wait a minute now, Reggie. I'm a Christian. I don't spend 20 hours in front of my car. Nope. How much time do you spend in front of the TV? Ooh. I don't want to step on anybody's toes, but something you might want to think about, okay? Or what other thing that takes up, how about PlayStation, video games, okay? You see how subtle idolatry can become? It can sneak in and can just begin to eat up the time and begin to capture us. And you're trying to read your Bible and you're thinking about, man, if I can just get off that one more level on speed demons, I could, man, And your mind just can't escape that, because all you're thinking about is getting off that next level, you know? Has it become an idol to you? Only you guys can answer that. One commentator once stated, idolatry is worshiping anything that ought to be used and using anything that ought to be worshiped. Remember 1 Corinthians 10:14 says, flee from idolatry. I know. It's one of those things that each of us has to look at in our own life and say, you know, how much time? Is this thing really that important? Especially when you compare that to the amount of time that you spend in the Word of God or in prayer or doing the things that God's called you to do, okay? You realize that your job can become an idol too? Reggie, we got to go to work. Yes, I understand. I know that. Okay. But you know at what point you have to say, it's time for me to go home. You have to know if you're so tired when you get home that you can't pick up your Bible or you can't spend time with your family, you can't play with your children. Okay. I'll do it tomorrow. I'll read tomorrow. Tomorrow comes around and what happens? I got a project due. I got to get it done. Verse 12. He who is far off will die by the plague, and he who is near will fall by the sword, and he who remains is besieged will die by the famine. Thus I will spend my wrath on them. Ezekiel was demonstrating this diverse behavior because of all the wicked and detestable practices of the house of Israel. Destruction by the sword or famine and plague summarized the judgment already enhanced by the prophet's fourth sign back in chapter 5 when he's talking about the cutting of the hair and he separated and talked about what each one represented. Those in Jerusalem who escaped one calamity would find another waiting to strike them down. Can you imagine that? There's no escape. There's no escape. Verse 13 reads, Then you will know that I am the Lord when their slain are among their idols, around their altars, on every high hill, on the tops of the mountains, under every green tree, and under every leafy oak, the place where you offer soothing aroma to all their idols. So throughout their habitations, I will stretch out my hand against them and make the land more desolate and waste than wilderness toward Diblah. Thus they will know that I am the Lord. Once again, we hear that. They will know that I am the Lord. The picture that is painted here of those who worship these idols is nothing but death and destruction. You see all these places of pagan worship, all those places that they went to so that they could satisfy their flesh, all those places they thought gave them happiness and fulfillment will now be nothing more than places of death for them. Their groves will turn into graves. This could also be said of us today. Or can we turn to the Lord and give our lives unto him as a living sacrifice? You see, God wants us to examine our hearts and our actions before him. God alone deserves our worship. And if you move away from him, you will find the things that you put your trust in will leave you high and dry. How often we've seen that. You'll be empty and you won't be satisfied. And as we've seen in this chapter, the Lord wants to make himself known to them again. And in these past four verses, we see that the Lord repeats himself twice by reminding them, then you shall know that I am the Lord. That was the desire for Israel and desire for us. to know that he is the Lord. Listen to this. One commentator wrote this about that statement, "They shall know that I am the Lord." Here's what he has been called, the holy, here is what has been called the holy and royal monogram. When this seal is attached, God himself vouches for the truth of what has been declared. This is so not only with words of judgment, but with precious promises of grace as well. The same unchangeable God who has announced that all have sinned has provided a blessed salvation for all through faith in Christ. As we bear the message of loving favor in Christ, man can know of a surety that our God is the Lord himself. What better credentials could be provided? As we desire the lost to obey the call of salvation, let us heed the call to witness, and we too shall know in a higher sense that God is the Lord. Amen. Now we're getting ready to enter into an area where it's going to get even heavier in the teaching. Let's move on into chapter 7, beginning at verse 1. "Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, and you, son of man, thus says the Lord God to the land of Israel, an end. The end is coming on four corners of the land, and now the end is upon you. And I will send my anger against you. I will judge you according to your ways and bring all your abominations upon you." Now, guys, I got to say that even in those first three verses, this is some pretty heavy stuff that's going on here. I mean, God is telling them what his judgment is going to be. God is bringing down the hammer. He's bringing down the hammer. It's hard to imagine that there's not wholesale repentance that just hasn't broken out all over the land. You hear stuff, you hear the word of the Lord come at you like this, you would think that the children of Israel would just run out and destroy all their idols and just fall on their face and ask for forgiveness and repentance. But there's not. And this just goes to show the hardness of the heart, the hardness of the human heart when it's filled with self. When we want what we want, despite the fact that we know the truth, we want what we want. When it's all about us, and that selfish attitude begins to build up within us, and we allow it, and we don't crucify that, we find that despite the fact that we know the truth, that we know the word of God, that we know what he's called us to be and what he's called us to do, we still want to do our own thing. The people would be judged according to their ways. That is, they would bring judgment upon themselves. And that's the way we are. Because when we get out there and we do the things that we want to do, and we have that selfish attitude, and we are all about us, and then God begins to do things in our life to draw us back, then all of a sudden we have an attitude towards God, right? "Lord, why are you allowing this to happen to me? Why are you letting this?" Well, you know why. You know why. You know why these things are going on in your life. And yet our pride prevents us from falling on our knees and repenting. Lord, it's just a little thing. It's just a little thing. Why can't I have this? It's just a little thing. All I want, come on, Lord, give me a break here. But the other side of that is the Lord knows what's good for us. And that's something that we forget about at times. He knows what we need and what we don't need. He knows those things that will be a stumbling block in our life. Remember when the children of Israel were entering into the promised land and the warnings that God gave the children of Israel about about the nations that they would come in contact with, what God told them not to do, not to give their children in marriage. Seems like a small thing. Some of the things seem so small. And yet God knew why. He had a reason. He understood what would be the outcome if these things continued, if he allowed these things to happen. We have to make sure daily that we're seeking the Lord through his word and through prayer, because he's only looking out for what's best for us. Parents, when you stop your kids and you say, no, don't do that, don't go there, you can't have that, is it because you're trying to be mean? No. It's because you know that not everything that they want is good for them. They want to buy all the candy in the store and you say, go right ahead. You know that that's going to result in cavities and a tummy ache later on. When Cindy and I go to Golden Corral, she says, Reggie, don't go back. Don't go back to the buffet. She knows that, okay, 5 plates is enough. Don't go back. That's too much. You're going to regret it later. God's the same way. And in a loving fashion, he says, no, you don't need that. Put it away. We need to be mindful of the Lord and his love for us. And we need to, that needs to be an encouragement to us. It's not a downer, it's a great thing. My God cares for me. He cares for me. False prophets, though, had been predicting deliverance for the Jews. But Ezekiel says, not so. The end has come. It's the end of the road for Jerusalem and the land. It's the end of the road for the Jews. The people will be judged according to their ways. That is, they would bring judgment upon themselves. And again, same with us. When we disobey, we reap what we sow, right? Now, in saying that, don't lose sight that our God is patient. He is long-suffering. You look at the stories throughout the Bible, and you look at your own life, and we can't deny the fact that he is long-suffering. My goodness, if he could continue on with somebody like me, as hard-headed as I am, he must be long-suffering. Peter, in speaking of God's coming judgment, said this in 2 Peter chapter 3. The Lord is not slack concerning his promises, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. Praise God for the long suffering of our Lord. Amen. Verse 4. For my eyes will have no pity on you, nor will I spare you, but I will bring you your ways upon you, and your abominations will be among you. Then you will know that I am the Lord. There it is again. Thus says the Lord God. A disaster, a unique disaster, behold, it is coming. An end is coming. The end has come. It has awakened against you. Behold, it has come. Your doom has come to you, O inhabitants of the land. The time has come. The day is near. Tumult rather than joyful shouting on the mountains. Now I will shortly pour out my wrath on you and spend my anger against you. Judge you according to your ways and bring on you all your abominations. My eyes will show no pity, nor will I spare. I will repay you according to your ways while your abominations are in your midst. Then you will know that I am the Lord. I, the Lord, do the smiting. Again, I cannot imagine hearing that from a prophet who's come in. Ezekiel's come in and walked in this room, and he proclaims God's word to us that way, and our hearts would be so hard that we would not give ear to what he's saying. And yet, they didn't listen. Has the Lord spoken to you concerning something that's going on in your life? Has the Lord put a finger on something that he needs you to deal with and deal with right now? Is your heart turned hard like the children of Israel here, to the point where now, where at one time it was a loud screaming voice, it's become a deadening whisper because your heart has become so hard that you refuse to let go? Turn back to the Lord. Hear his voice and be obedient. Be obedient. Repent. Because the pleas of God had fallen on deaf ears, Ezekiel was charged to declare that the entire land of Israel was ripe for judgment. The time of God's patience had run out, and punishment could no longer be averted. We never want to get to that point, do we? Never want to get to that point. No part of the land would be exempt from the stroke of God. The thought of the end was repeated for emphasis and to underscore the truth that there was no further hope. It was coming. It was coming. Sin had run its course. Judgment alone remained. As you read this, notice the complete destruction upon the southern kingdom of Judah, and the end has come upon the four corners of the land. God was done. So it's not just Jerusalem, but all the land of the southern kingdom of Judah, including Jerusalem. He says, now the end has come upon you. God warned them, and they refused to listen. Has our heart grown so hard and so cold that we are not listening? There was a need to enforce and reinforce the heart of the message so that when the blow did fall, they would realize that the Lord is a God of judgment and the visitation had come truly from him. Verse 10, behold the day, behold it is coming, your doom has gone forth, the rod has budded, arrogancy has blossomed, violence has grown into a rod of wickedness. None of them shall remain, none of their people, none of their wealth, nor anything eminent among them. The time has come. The day has arrived. Let not the buyer rejoice, nor the seller mourn, for wrath is against all their multitude. Indeed, the seller will not regain what he sold Indeed, the seller will not regain what he has sold as long as they both live. For the visitation regarding all their multitude will not be averted, nor will any of them maintain his life by his iniquity. In other words, commerce will cease in Jerusalem. Babylon will control the business of the city. Now we know that according to the law, property was to be returned to its original owner every 50 years. In Ezekiel's day, however, this wouldn't matter, since rightful owners would most likely either be killed by the famine or the sword or pestilence, or they would be in captivity in Babylon. You can't buy your way into heaven. In other words, their riches and spiritual valueness, only Jesus can save you. their riches would not have any spiritual value. Thus, the door is open for both the rich and the poor to be saved. All can come to him, but many times riches get in the way. Jesus talked about that in the New Testament. What do you trust in more? More importantly, who do you trust in? Are you trusting in your riches? Are you trusting in the true and living God? Verse 14, they have blown the trumpet and made everything ready, but no one is going to the battle, for my wrath is against all their multitude. The Hebrew military will fail. When the battle trumpet blows, no one will have the will to fight. They have an army of deserters now, of cowards. Verse 15, the sword is outside and the plague and the famine are within. He who is in the field will die by the sword. Famine and plague will also consume those in the city. Even when their survivors escape, they will be on the mountain like doves of the valleys, and all of them mourning each over his own iniquity. Israel will find that she has no defense against God's judgment and no escape from God's judgment. Outside would bring the sword, inside plague and famine. Those who sought escape outside Jerusalem's wall were hunted down and murdered by the Babylonian army. Those who sought protection within the city's wall faced the dual enemies of famine and disease. The majority of the people would die, and even those who survived would pay a hefty price. Again, I can only go back to the fact that you hear this judgment coming upon you, and their hearts were so hard that they wouldn't turn back. The pitiful wail of those hiding in the mountains who were weeping over their sins and material losses would sound like mourning doves. Over what? Loss of material things. Better we should be mourning over the fact that we are in sin and there has been no repentance by the nation. Verse 17, all hands will hang limp and all knees will become like water. They will gird themselves with sackcloth. Shuddering will overwhelm them, and the shame will be on all faces and baldness on all their heads. They will fling their silver into the streets, and their gold will become an abhorrent thing. Their silver and their gold will not be able to deliver them in the day of the wrath of the Lord. They cannot satisfy the appetite, nor can they fill their stomachs, for their iniquity has become an occasion of stumbling. They were incapable of any resistance. Sackcloth, baldness upon their heads, these were the signs of mourning and humiliation. As much as they loved gold and silver, and as important as it was for them, now it was worthless. When you're starving and you're starving to death, you can't eat your gold and silver. And if there was no food, it didn't matter anyway how much money they had, right? Psalm 49 says this, those who trust in their wealth and boast in the multitude of their riches, none of them can by any means redeem his brother nor give God a ransom for him. These people's hearts were so hard against the Lord. Aren't we grateful that we have a loving and merciful and forgiving God? Aren't we grateful that today that all we need to do is cry out to him, run to him and repent, turn from our sins. And you know what? We get up, we brush ourselves off, and we get back in the race. We don't have to go back to start over again. We continue on. We have a God that loves us. Loves us so much so that when we turn away, he's constantly trying to pull us back in. It's all about restoration, isn't it? Coming back to him, living for him. Even when he puts us out for a season, it's all about bringing us back and restoring us. That's the God that I want to serve. That's the God I want to live for. Especially knowing my weakened state, knowing that this flesh is always crying out for satisfaction. This flesh always wants what it wants. That I have not yet learned to bring it under submission to the will of God. I'm still growing. I'm still learning. I'm a far, far away from being that, being everything that he wants me to be. But in the same light, I serve a God that's long-suffering and patient to say, okay, Reggie, I got you. Come on. And step by step, he's teaching me and helping me to grow and to learn and to turn away from those things and to recognize a trap when I see it. You know, some of us can be walking and there's going to be a big hole in the middle of the road, signs, neon signs and everything. And we know that if we keep going that way, we're going to fall into it. And yet we just keep walking straight ahead. We keep walking right into the pit. And sometimes we have to have a God who will push us to the right or to the left so we can go around and miss it. As I said from the outset, I love being saved. I love that I have a God who looks out for me, who cares for me. And I can't wait. I can't wait to get there to see him. How about you? Amen. Let's all stand. We'll finish chapter 7 next week and move on into 8. Some heavy stuff here tonight, huh? Yeah. Sometimes it's good for us to go through things like this, for us to do some self-examination, to make sure that we are being obedient to the word of God. I want to live for him, and I want to please my God so much. And yet, like I said, in my selfishness, there are times when I know that I don't know if disappointment is the word, because we can't disappoint him since he knows where we're going and what we're doing, but I just break the heart, as it said in the word, that I just break the heart of my God. Father God in heaven, forgive me, forgive us, Lord, for those times, Lord, we forget about you, Lord. We are caught up with self. Father, help us to be the men and women you called us to be. Help us to live the life, Lord, that you've laid out for us, Lord. Help us to trust you more, Lord, and to love you more. Lord, I thank you for those you've gathered here tonight and this time we've got to spend together. We ask your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen.